Well, here we are, about to unbox an executive-grade phone within the TIPT environment. Where would you see this phone sitting within the scale of available handsets, Chris?
Oh, well, it's at the upper end of Cisco's range.
So an executive phone.
That's right.
Now, here it all is. We might just mention that this is a switch that we're going to be plugging it into, but this is what comes in the box. We get the handset itself. Lovely. And it's an executive version. You can see large screen. And you know what I think's really good about this? It's come with a Cat 5 or Cat 6 cable in the box. This allows you to just plug it in straight away and get going with it.
That's right, which if you're using PoE or PoE Plus, depending on the phone model, means that it's ready for that particular source of power straight away.
Power over Ethernet.
Correct.
Yeah, very good. We might have a quick tour as to what's on the front, then turn it over and actually start assembling this. Now, I can see already that we've got lights, lines buttons here. We'll know that when that turns on. They look like soft keys.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
We've got a voicemail function, a settings function, a phone book function. I'm assuming that's going to be volume. We've got a hold. The pause button is a hold.
Mm-hmm.
This is for conferencing, I'm gathering.
Or transferring.
Or transferring, yes, transfer the call, conferencing. And whether you want to answer your phone via headset, speaker, or mute.
Correct.
And, of course, the standard keys.
Oh, well, and there's also here, you can see menu back.
The go back button.
And
of course,
up.
The hang up button. And a cursor button.
Correct.
All good. And easy, right? But the fact is, I'm treating this as if I'm a very new user. We haven't even looked at the manual, and most of this stuff makes sense. All right, let's flip it over and have a look. And here it is. Why don't we start from left to right, Chris? I think it's pretty easy to say that that's going to be power if you don't want to use power over Ethernet. We've got a USB point for any USB connected devices.
Well, also, because it's yellow, that tells you that it's supplying power, even if the phone's in power save mode, so you might be able to charge things there as well.
Perfect. All right. That looks like a LAN icon, and I'm assuming that's how you'd connect the phone. Into a TIPT environment.
Yeah, now let's talk about these two ports
that's a computer
together.
One.
That's right.
Yeah.
So they're both RJ45, so they're both oriented towards what you'd call a structured cabling connection for LAN.
And that's...
But the difference between these is that that symbol indicates that that port is meant to go from the port from the phone to the LAN, and this one is meant to go from the phone to a subtended PC.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're in an office environment now where you have one port available at the desk from the LAN and you have a PC and a phone that you'd like to connect, it's quite common these days for the PC to connect through the phone. And that's showing you that this phone is designed to support that arrangement.
That's terrific because many desks, I should say, only have a single RJ45 port, not two.
That's
as it might have been the case many years ago.
That's right. So to the LAN, to the PC.
Okay. And so the PC basically passes through, the connection to the PC passes through the phone into the LAN. All right. An auxiliary port, that'll be for things like fixed headsets and so on. And then we've got what looks like a 3.5mm mini jack, as they call it, for an external speaker and one for a microphone. There's another port here for a headset.
That's
and
right.
Also for the handset.
That's right.
Why don't we plug that in? All right. I think we should. Now, trap for young players, because I've made mistakes like this in the past. There's a long end and a short end to these cables. The long end is the bit that goes into the phone. Otherwise, it just doesn't manage the connection through nice cable tidy. All right, which we put in like so. While we're showing the back, why don't we also plug in the Cat 5 or Cat 6 cable, and we'll put it into the LAN port. Now, I'm going to just lean the cable over to this side, Chris, because by the time we turn it over, it will be in the right spot to connect into the switch. And of course, now we're going to plug in, we'll assemble the stand, and that just goes into these slots like so. Here we go. Time to turn it over. All right. Let's turn it back over again. Now, we'll tilt it up in a second so that everyone can see what's going on. But in the meantime, I'm also going to plug the handset, the other end of the cable, into the handset. And here it is. We're assembled. And all we've got to do now is really to plug it in and see if it's working.
That's
now,
right.
Obviously, at work, you just plug it into the available port that's on your desk. In this case, I'm going to plug it into the switch. But before we do, there's a reason why we've done it in this order, right, Chris?
That's right. We're giving you an example of power over Ethernet. Now, that means that as soon as you plug it into the switch or to the wall port, if you're using power over Ethernet, the phone will try to boot.
Right.
And you don't want that happening while you're still assembling it.
Okay. Yeah, that's true. All right. So I'm going to plug it in right now. And let's have a look at what happens on the screen while this is going on. So it's now plugged in, and there's a flash saying hello.
Yeah, so we know now that the handset has got power from the switch. We actually can see the switch, so we know that things are happening because we can see the lights blinking. You possibly can't see that
there
when you're at your desk.
And let's have a look. There's the Cisco logo that's come up.
Okay,
that's
so
a good start.
What that's telling us is that...
lights are flashing.
Is that the phone is happy that it's got service from the switch, it's got its power, everything's starting to go through the process of booting up. Now, from this point forward, what the phone will do is start to try to contact TIPT. So it's going to communicate with a DHCP server, and we have one connected to our lab here that is going to provide an IP address. It's going to provide information about where its router is and other technical bits and pieces. But importantly as well, it's going to tell it where TIPT is.
Here we go. Systems booting. There was a screen that came up there. Configuration check is in process. This may take a few minutes. This is a good start. I feel as though we're doing all right.
It's certainly progressing the right way so far. Now, what happens next, what we see on the screen next, is going to tell us a little bit about whether or not we have configured our LAN correctly.
Okay.
If your DHCP server is not configured correctly, you might be able to tell that the prompts are different to what they should be. And so what we expect to see when the phone has booted up completely and connected to TIPT and knows that it can reach TIPT, it will give us an opportunity to enter a username and a password.
Okay.
If you don't get a username and password box, then that means that there is something probably not right with your LAN configuration.
And there it is. The username and passwords come up.
That's right. And that's a very, very good indication that the phone has been able to contact TIPT. And now it knows that it needs to be able to log in
right.
in order to then do the next part of the setup.
Okay. Now, this will be the information that I got on the email
that was
sent to me in
order to be
a new user within the TIPT environment.
That's right.
What if we don't have this?
Then you can't register or log in and get
right.
the phone to register with TIPT straight away. So you need that information.
Okay. So, Chris, as you mentioned before, if you don't get this screen, you need to contact your administrator. And if you don't get the email with the information that you're going to need to plug in for your username and password, contact your administrator.
That's right. Now, you might find that the administrator actually doesn't give you the original email. He might provide, or she might provide you with... the information in some other format,
mm-hmm.
but there is an email available. It's called Device Queue Setup.
Yep.
And that's the information that you need to log in.
All right, now I've put in my username and password, and the password was a very long string of numbers because we're using a number pad rather than an alphanumeric pad. And I moved from one field to the other just using this cursor key here to go down. So I don't know, should we just hit the go button?
Hit sign in.
All right. And it's now signing into the account, as we can see. And the sign... wow, that was quick. It's fantastic. All right. Sign is successful. I will hit the OK button.
And it's applying some configuration information.
The system's booting, but I thought we did that already.
Yeah, what happens after you've successfully logged in,
mm.
it can now check its configuration, check its firmware, and TIPT DMS up in the cloud will push down new configuration files and new firmware if needed. And so the phone has applied those and then wants to reboot in order to make them active.
All right. And in the time that we've been talking about that, there's my phone number and it's all up and running. Well, there's only one way to make sure we've done it right, and that's to make a call. Should I make it or will you ring me?
I'll ring you now.
Okay. Why don't we do that? And there it is. I better answer it, I suppose. Hello, this is Toby Travener.
Hello, Toby.
Excellent. Oh, thanks very much, Chris. And there you go. We did it. I'm really pleased. You know what I liked about this? This is basically everything is kind of almost plug and play, right? You just plug, assemble the phone, plug it in, and then TIPT does the rest.